Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it looks like we are live. I hope my lighting is okay. So I'll just leave this and go straight on into the event. Let me just post something to the K-Land guys. Thank you very much, everyone. So I've set up the streaming for the video streaming. So I'll send you a link to the video streaming platform. It will be very much appreciated if some of us, or at least all of us, go there just, you know, to see a video demonstration of some of the things that I'm going to be talking about. So in about 10 seconds, I'll share the link. So once everyone is there, you just type in the channel and let me know, and then we'll proceed from there. Okay, so I've got the video link. Let's just share it with you guys. Right. So when you get here and you see it, let me know. So ladies and gentlemen, you're welcome to today's presentation on fundamentals of footwear patterns. I've also been told that quite some of us will also need it to be broken down in bits that we can appreciate. So every once in a while, you're going to notice say at the switch between English and Pidgin. I'm sorry that my Yoruba is not very, very good otherwise. I would have used Yoruba, as the case may be, but I go use English, I go use Pidgin, and I hope that as many people as possible will be able to follow. So what we are discussing today is the fundamentals of footwear patterns. So let's start first of all by asking ourselves, what is a pattern? Waiting be pattern. But before then, let me say thank you to Mr. Kushimo, thank you to Kaylan, and then let me introduce myself. My name is Victor Onyebado. I'm the owner of the brand called Kpomo Bespoke. We make shoes and we teach shoemaking. Then also, I have a consultancy firm called Shoecademy, which consults for governments, consults for people in the footwear industry, things related to how to source materials, how to source equipment, how to train your people. We do all of those. So if you need those kind of services, now we think we did do with that, just knock on our door. I'm a self-taught shoemaker. I taught myself basically how to make shoes. So much of what you are going to be hearing from me are things that I came about from extensive reading, extensive research, extensive observation, and of course, practice. Like they say, practice leads to perfection. So I have practiced some of these things that I'm going to be discussing with you, and they are things that I have seen that really, really work. Now, what are we going to be discussing today? we're going to be discussing, this is an outline of some of the things that we are going to be, this is an outline of some of the things that we're going to be discussing today. We're going to be discussing feet anatomy. When you take a human foot and look at it, what are the things that you see there? It is those things that you see on your feet that determine the pattern for the shoe that you are going to make. Of course, even the shoe last that we all know. I have a pair of shoe last here. You see that this shoe last is designed to resemble a feet somehow. It's not exactly, no resemble feet completely. But somehow, some way, it is designed to resemble a human feet. Why is it designed this way? What are the things that we need to see on the shoe last to help us in designing our shoe pattern? So those are the things that we will touch on when we are dealing with feet anatomy for shoemakers. Then we will now look at the pattern of classic shoes. When I say classic shoes, I don't mean beautiful shoes. I mean the most basic type of shoes. So you are talking about things like Oxfords or Derbies or loafers. I'll use an example of a Derby. So we will break it down and find out what will be those components of that Derby that makes it look as good as it is. You know, the thing with some of us is that we pick up shoes and they look good and we just start designing. You take the shoe and you start drawing, sketching from your head or what you think it should be, not knowing that the man who designed it had some calculations that he did that made him put a certain line in a certain place, that made him put a certain hole in a certain place, that made him, you know, measure something to be a certain length. Those are the things that we are also going to be looking at, hopefully, as the night progresses. So, having looked at feet anatomy, we'll look at the pattern of classic shoes. And then we'll look at some of the patterning techniques, things like last taping, locating the cardinal points on your last, and then we'll talk about mean forms. So all of these things that I'm talking about may sound like BB grammar, but don't worry yourself. They are not really, really big grammar. They are things that if you calm down and look at them, you on your own be able to locate them and use them to create better patterns. So having dealt with mean forms, we would also talk about measuring the different parts of your pattern. And then if we have time, we can also look at springing. So that's it. Let's go into feet anatomy for shoemakers. Now, feet anatomy for shoemakers, if you are in the Kalan WhatsApp group and you are also on the YouTube, indicate for me so that I know that you are really following and that you are seeing the slides that I'm sharing. In any case, those of us who are not on YouTube, when we are done presenting, I would also share the complete slides that I'm using on the YouTube. I would also share it in the WhatsApp group. So if you are not able to make it to the YouTube, don't worry, you would also have the slides in the WhatsApp group. But usually helps if you are on the same page with me on YouTube so that things will flow easily. So feet anatomy for shoemakers. When you take a human feet, shoemakers, we are not doctors, we are not anatomy practitioners. All we need on the human foot, you know, you see some books, some textbooks on shoemaking. You see some textbooks on shoemaking, and several of them go into talking about things like the metatarsal bone and all of those. No. I'm really not interested in those ones. What I'm really interested in are, what are those parts of the shoe that I need to be able to design a shoe that is comfortable to my customer, shoe that is not only comfortable but is also healthy for my customer, and then shoe that also looks good for my customer. For me, in my experience, and then also what you will see in many of the standard textbooks is that there are several parts of the human feet that a shoemaker needs to keep himself abreast of. Those are the parts that you really need to pay attention to, and they are the ones that I have shown in this drawing here. There is what is called the ball. The ball runs from the right to the left. No, you know, if you take your feet, let me see if so. This is a last, for instance. The ball is from here, the inside to the outside. That is the widest part on your feet. It's also the widest part on the last. So if you run a line from here to there, that is called the ball. If you run a line around the entire feet like that, the circumference of it, that is called the ball girth. So the reason why the ball is important is because it is the widest point on your feet. And then when you are measuring the feet of your customer to create a pattern for the shoe that you want to make for him, you must ensure that the last that you use has ball that is equal or bigger, slightly bigger than the ball of your customer. Otherwise, his leg will not be able to enter the shoe. Even if it enters, it will be very tight for him and very uncomfortable, and at times even unhealthy for him to wear. So that is the ball, and that is the importance of the ball. So that's the two parts that you see here that I am holding, the ball of the feet. Now, the next part on the last that I want to talk about, the waist is not very important, because usually when you calculate the ball, the waist falls in place. Of course, if you are making solid bespoke shoes, you need to calculate them and factor those in. But usually when you get your ball correct, the last will usually take care of the waist, right? The more important part that you will now need to take care of is the instep. The instep is this part, this highest part on the last here. If you touch your feet, there's a bone at that place called the instep bone, really. And it is the highest point on your feet. It is somewhere around here. So you measure it by putting a tape. I'm using my hand to record for WhatsApp. Otherwise, I would have just taken a tape to demonstrate it. Okay, let me just finish talking, then I'll demonstrate it for those of us who are on YouTube. So if you take a last and run it around like that, you can measure the circumference and get what is called the instep girth. It is important, especially if you are making a boot. If you are making a boot and your instep is lower than what it is on your customer's feet, the foot of the customer will not be able to enter, especially in Chelsea boots, for instance. If it's a derby boot, then of course the lace, you can open it and then the man will be able to slot his feet in. However, even when he slots his feet in, you'd find out that because your instep is short, he will not be able to close back the lace comfortably. So you will notice that there is a problem in the patterning, right? So that is why the instep is very, very important. When I finish recording on the WhatsApp, I'll use a tape to demonstrate to you exactly how the instep and the ball are calculated. So I'll drop this chat right now on the WhatsApp group, and then I'll demonstrate those on this last. So I typically measure with centimeters. So this is for those of us who are on YouTube. I measure with centimeters. So to measure your ball will be from here to there, the ball. The ball girth, however, which is the circumference between the two of them, is all around like this. Typically, if you place your last on a flat surface like this, you can mark out the ball. You place it on a flat surface like that, you can mark out the ball. I have several videos on my YouTube channel, which is the YouTube channel that you're watching this presentation on. If you check out my videos on the low fast coaching class. Even the what's that one called? The one on Oxford, the Oxford's class. I think it's called Dapper Dan. So it's a whole playlist of about 6, 7, 8 videos. All of these things are demonstrated in granular details. I'm beginning to blow plenty English again, but the point I was making is that these things are demonstrated in details, right? And then you can really see how all of that plays out. But the most important point, what I want to make, when I take away from all that I have been saying, is that you need to calculate these 2 points so that the leg of your customer will fit enter inside the shoe after you've made the pattern. You hear people complain sometimes and say, I make the shoe for the man, he say it too tight, or I make him, he say it too loose. All of that is as a result of the fact that you did not calculate either the ball or the instep. If you don't calculate the instep, if your instep is too much, the man's leg will be swimming inside the shoe. And also for your ball, really, the man will be wearing the shoe and his leg will be swimming inside the shoe. And then sometimes, because it is not his size, when he walks with it, he will deform the shoe, and after like a week, the shoe will not look nice. However, if you make shoes that fit the customer correctly, then it will look nice, and it will last, and it will be healthy, and it will be you be regarded as a much better craftsman going the way. By the way, so I've talked about the balls, I've talked about the instep. Another important thing that shoemakers need to measure is what I call the last length. If you watch some of my older videos, I used to use the term standard last length. I no longer use the term standard last length. The reason why I don't use standard last length is because I don't see anything standard about these lengths. You know, the only standards are from last makers. So some people measure the last length at the bottom of the last, like this, from this place to that. They take the measurement, like here now it is 22.5 cm. However, I measure my own last length from here, from the back, like this, then along the side of the lateral side, which is the outside part, then down to the tip of the last, like this. I'm not sure this is very clear, but so while I got 22, here it's about 25 right here. So this is how I measure my standard last length. Oh, sorry, not the standard last length, my last length. So it runs from the back here all the way across there. The reason why it's important to measure this last length is because many of the parts of your pattern are going to be proportions or subdivisions of this last length. Now, this is a very important point I want to make here. The parts of your pattern are not determined arbitrarily. You don't just, it look nice, I go just do them like that. If you are a good artist, if you know how to sketch things, you can just by looking at it and find out what is proportional, what is okay. But not many of us, Sabi, not many of us are artists. Not many of us got A in fine arts when we were in primary or secondary school. For those of us who are not very good with sketching, it is important to take particular care of your measurements. So why am I saying this? If you measure your last length, by the time I start showing you patterning of classic shoes, I have forgotten to record for the WhatsApp, but I'll get back. I'll summarize everything I've been saying in the WhatsApp group shortly. By the time I get back to patterning of classic shoes, you see how even the very renowned shoemakers, the John Lobbs, the Carminias, how they themselves use these measurements in designing those shoes that you consider top range and beautiful shoes. So I'll show you that in a minute. So the point I'm making, just in summary, in anatomy of a shoe, I've talked about the ball, I've talked about the instep, then I have talked about the last length. All right? Now, 1 second. All right, so thank you very much, Mr. Kushimo. Thank you very much, Mr. Kushimo. I see that there are quite a number of people on the live stream, and that's very, very encouraging. So I think I have spoken quite a lot about the anatomy. So let me go to how to now take these measurements. As you can see, on this picture here that I have, if you place your foot against a wall, you can actually trace the outline of your feet and, you know, just take those measurements as the case may be. If you're still hearing me on YouTube, please confirm that I'm still audible. I'm not sure, I had some glitches with my connection, but I think I'm back on now. I think I'm back on now and everything is all right. Okay, so I was speaking about taking the measurements of your feet. So to take this measurement, you can see how this person is. You typically want the customer to wear the type of socks that he will wear. So in measuring your feet, you typically want the customer to wear the type of socks that he will usually wear when he's going to be using the shoe. And then you ask him to put his feet against the wall and you trace the outline. Then you use you do what I did on this last, on the feet. You measure the ball, you measure the instep, you take the grit, the circumference of them, and then you use all of those in matching it to your last. So the measurements you got on the customer's feet, you would want to match it to the last, and then that is when you know that you have the correct last that can work for that customer. So What you're seeing here is the length of the feet, and this is the width. So you see, this is the ball here. This is the outside ball. This is the inside ball. And then this is the length of the feet. This, of course, is going to be used in determining the sole of the feet. And then when you place a last, you must ensure that there is a room, that there is some clearance in front there, which is called the toe clearance, so that the shoe can have some breathing space inside of the leg of the customer, the feet of the customer can have some breathing space inside of the shoe. So this is how to measure the ball and width grit, as I mentioned. So you can see that the tape is taped around like so, and then measured all the way around. This is how to measure the instep grit, as you can see that the tape goes all the way around, and then they find the measurement at this point here. So when you take this measurement and you put it, when you take this measurement, the measurement of this instep grit, and you place it on the last, you are also trying to ensure that it matches it, or that it is slightly above but never below what you got on the customer's feet. So once you've gotten all of these measurements down, it is now time. Once you've gotten all of these measurements on your customer's feet, it is now time to now go into the nitty-gritty of creating the pattern. To demonstrate to you, to demonstrate to us, some of the things that I personally consider when I am creating patterns. And if you have watched some of my YouTube videos, you probably are familiar with these things that I do. The reason why I take all of that pain in doing these things that I do, I'm going to use an example of a classic shoe. That this is a shoe made by a classic shoemaker in London called John Lobb. If you Google John Lobb and search for them, they have a very, very rich history of shoemaking. And I think that with that rich history of shoemaking, they are a good place to take reference from. So this is a classic brogued toe-capped derby that was made by John Lobb. And you see that everything looks proportional, everything looks in place. And I want to show you all of those plenty masks that some of you complain that I do in my videos or that I do with my patterns. I want to show you how all of that plays out in a beautiful shoe like this. So hang on, I'll show you exactly what I mean in a minute. So you take a look. One second.
You have 1 hour for teaching.
Okay.
And we have 30 minutes for question and answer.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
All right, then. I think I've just done about 33 minutes. Excellent.
You have 1 hour for teaching.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Kushimo. So now let's take a look at this shoe right here. Now you know that I talked about the last length. So the last length will be the length running from the back here all the way down here to the tip. That's looking at this right, this shoe on the right side, this one that you are seeing the side view and not the one with the front view. So it runs from the back to the front like this. Take a look at this cap toe. By just looking at it, you can see that this cap toe is about 1/4 of that last length. So which is why I call it the rule of quarters. It is, if you take that last length and divide it into 4, that distance is the distance from the tip right here to the end of this, to the width of this cap toe here. And then from here also to where the facing starts is also like 1/4 of that last length. Then from where the facing starts to where it ends here, which is around the instep, is also like 1/4 of the last length. So you see that there is everything is divided into quarters, and this shoe does not look out of proportion. Am I saying that you must keep all of your parts 1/4 of your last length? No. All I am saying is that the classic, the people that we learned the work from are going by these rules, which tells us that if you play by these rules, your shoe will most probably turn out proportional. Your shoe will most probably turn out looking, at least in terms of proportion, as good as this. You know, it's always good to know the rules and then break the rules after you know the rules. But if you start designing, let's say for instance that you took your cap toe and you started it somewhere here. I have done that before. I made a very beautiful boot that the only thing that was wrong with it was that the cap toe extended way too much into the vamp, and that just ruined the entire aesthetics of that shoe. The shoe was made out of solid leather, everything, stitching was good, finishing was good, everything was good, except that cap toe that was just much more than 1/4 of the last length. I ended up dashing that boot to someone else. If not for that cap toe, I probably would still have been wearing that boot up to today. But the point that I'm trying to get across to you is that in patterning, there is a rule, a general rule of design, that all of the parts of the shoe that lie along, let me not say it's a rule, it's an observation that I have made, that all of the parts, at least for the classic shoes, all of the parts that lie along the length of the shoe, that lie along it like that, are 1/4 of the last length. Then all of the parts that lie across like this are 1/8 of the last length. So let's take this facing now from here to here. You see that if you take the distance of from here up to here, that it is 1/8 of this last length. If you take this last length and divide it by 8, let's say this last length is, let's say, 37, for instance, or let's say 36, for instance, then 1/4 of, let's say it's 32, 1/4 of 32 will be 8, and then 1/8 of that will be 4. So this will probably be 4 cm, approximately, you know? So that usually is a guide. What I do is, when I want to break the rule that I have just said, this rule of quarters, I first of all design a shoe that complies with the rules. Then I can now start saying, okay, I don't want, rather than use 1/4, let me use 1/4 plus 1 cm, or 1/4 plus or minus, to suit my own taste. But the point is that you know the rules first, and then you are able to break the rules. These things are much more better when demonstrated. And like I said, I have several videos on my YouTube channel where I have explained this thing in very, very, very granular details. And it will help if you take advantage of those videos. So the point I'm making is, if you are going to design a shoe, pay attention that all of the parts that lie along the last length are approximately, all of the subdivisions are approximately 1/4 of that last length. So from here, for instance, to there is 1/4. From there to there, about 1/4. From there up to here, about 1/4 again. And even from the back like this up to this point, which is the heel, is 1/4. You know, I usually have had many people ask, what is the measurement of the heel? How do I measure the heel and ensure that I have accurate? I simply tell them 1/4 of your last length. And if you take your regular last, for instance, let me see if I have a last here. I think I should have one. If you take those lasts that they put a metal plate underneath it, you'd find that that metal plate, the length of that metal plate is 1/4 of the last length, showing you that the last makers themselves are also complying with that rule. Why should you on your own be breaking it? Of course, you can break it when you have mastered, when you're a master of the trade. A master can do what he likes, but then a master is also someone who knows the rules well enough to be able to break it. So my recommendation is, in creating your patterns, know the rules first, and then you are able to break it as you go along. I hope I'm not speaking plenty grammar. So patterning techniques, the number one patterning technique is taping up the last. Don't just pick up a last and start putting leather on it. You need to tape the last, put masking tape on the last. So this is a last, for instance. So you cover it with masking tape and then draw your design. using those rules that I spoke about in the earlier slides to draw your design on the masking tape. Now, you see many people tape one side of the last and design on that one side of the last. On a last like this, which is very, very symmetrical, which, you know, this deep, this curve here is not very, very steep, you can get away with it. But if you have lasts that have very, very steep curves, you would find that the proportion of your inside to your outside are very, very different. So if you just design on one side of the last, you would have errors, because that thing you designed on the outside of the last will not match what you have on the inside. Which is why I usually start by taping both sides of the last and using those both sides of the last to generate what I call a mean form. I cannot on this class demonstrate to you how to create a mean form, but if you go on my YouTube channel and search, you'll see that I have several videos dealing with how to create a mean form. A mean form simply is taking care of the proportion of what you have on the inside like this, combining it with the proportion of what you have on the outside like this, and using that to find the average, something that will work for this side and also work for this side. That is called a mean form. If you design with a mean form, you find out that those times that you would find shoemakers who will put Marco in front here to part this place up so that they don't have rumples in front at the front like this. Once you design with a mean form, you will not have that problem, because you have factored in the both sides of your last and your patterns will become very, very accurate. So that's what I said here about the advantages of designing with a mean form. It gives you, it lets you deal with the discrepancies or the differences that you might have between the inside and the outside. Of course, if you need further explanation on mean forms, I can, in fact, mean form is something that we can take one full class and spend 2 hours dealing with mean forms and the next thing that I'm about to talk about, which is also springing. Now, before I'm going to talk about springing on YouTube before I go to the KLAN WhatsApp group. Now, if you take this last for instance, you see that there is a curve that runs from here. Now, in designing this pattern, let me go back. Let me make this big enough. Sorry, if you're on YouTube, hold on, I'm trying to set up something. So, talking head. So, now, this is the last. I was talking about springing. So, if you take this last like this, you see that there is a curve that runs from this place down like this. It runs from the top down like this. Now, when you create a mean form, you have factored in the difference between the outside part like this and the inside part. So your pattern will be accurate and correct. Now, to create a pattern for this last, however, this curve that runs like this, you see some shoemakers, after they have lasted their shoe, they have rumples here. They have excess material that they could not deal with at the front part like this. That's because they are either having a problem with their mean forms or that they are having a problem with their springing. So the technique of springing helps you deal with this curve, because this is not a straight line, and in trying to duplicate the parts of your pattern, you are going to have to duplicate it along a center line, along the center line here. So springing is a technique that we use in patterning to straighten out this curve, straighten it out in a straight line. That way you are able to duplicate the two parts, both the part that falls on the inside and the part that falls on the outside, so that you'd have accurate pattern. Like I said, it is difficult to explain in a video, but if you guys need me to recommend some of the videos that I have on the channel that deals with different aspects of springing. And that is a place that many shoemakers really, really have problems. So it's a technique that you need to learn and deploy in creating patterns. So the point I'm making is that you don't just take a shoe last, throw leather on it and start designing. No, you need to pay attention to those things that I have talked about, which are number one. Let's go back to the rule of quarters that I mentioned. So every part, so I mentioned earlier on that every part, that every part lying along, that lying along the, every part lying along the center, along the length of the last needs to be 1/4, and every part lying across the last will need to be 1/8 of the last length. So those are some of the most fundamental principles that I taught. If you apply them to your shoemaking techniques, they would help you to create much more consistent, much more standard patterns. And then when you learn those rules, you can now be able to tinker around and then break them as the case may be. Please, gentlemen, pardon me, my Yoruba is completely crappy. My wife is actually Yoruba, but I have not been able to learn Yoruba since I came to Lagos. But rest assured, my children know how to speak Yoruba. Otherwise, I would have interspaced and interlaced my presentation today with Yoruba. But nonetheless, I believe that you guys were able to get some things out of what I have discussed today. I will now invite us to ask questions. I think questions will be in order right now. So if you have any questions, whether in the KLAN WhatsApp group or on YouTube, I'll be happy to take them right now. So I think this is a good time to ask questions. So for the benefit of those in the WhatsApp group, I stopped recording to the WhatsApp group a while ago. The summary of everything that I have been saying is that there are rules to patterning, and those rules are important for us to identify. They are important for us to note and important for us to imbibe. And those rules are, I talked about mean forms. So when you are creating your patterns, you take your last and factor in both the outside and the inside, factor in the proportions of both the outside and the inside, and use that in creating your patterns. The second rule is that for classic shoes, really, I'm recording with my hand, so I don't have the use of my second hand. So for classic shoes, all the parts lying along the length will typically look nice if you stick with making it 1/4 of the last length, and all the parts lying across the last like that will usually look nice if you make it 1/8 of the last length. And of course, that means that you would have calculated your last length and are able to replicate it in your patterning. And then the final thing that I have talked about today is that in creating your pattern, you must make sure that you find the ball so that the feet of your customer can slide in, and that you also find your instep so that if it's a boot, his feet would also slide in. And then even if it is not a boot, his feet will not dance around inside the shoe and then ultimately deform the shoe when you wear it. So I've been speaking for 51 minutes. I was told I have 1 hour, but I think I would want to pause at this moment and invite you guys to ask questions. And then if there are need for more explanations, we can proceed from that. Thank you very much. Thank you once again for having me. God bless you. And I will now invite you guys to throw in the questions. Thank you. Please be okay. I'm seeing some. Okay, yeah. So you can either put your questions on YouTube or in the Kaylan WhatsApp group. Either of those is completely fine by me. I'll be able to address them either way that you send them. Okay, someone said, which book can I recommend for shoe patterning techniques? There are several books. There are free ones. Now, if you know me, I'm not... Let me record this for the Kaylan WhatsApp group. There are several books. Somebody asked the question of which book can I recommend. There are several books. I own some of them. Some of them are free ones. Some of them are not free. I'm not one of those people who share books that authors are selling. I now share them for free. No, I don't do it. If it was my own book that I wrote, I could give you for free. But if it was written by someone else, it's copyright infringement to share someone else's book with you, right? So the free ones I can easily share on the WhatsApp chat, and I think I can even post a link of them to this video when I finish recording. But there's a book, a very very good book, called Footwear Pattern Design, written by a gentleman called Wade, W-A-D-E, Wade Montao. I think he's from Philippines or so. Very good book. I own one. But it's for sale. I think it's about $10 to $15. I'm not very sure. $15 is not so much money. $15 is about, let's say, 15,000 naira, if 1,000 naira to a dollar. That's like profit that you can make out of one shoe. And if you invest that in buying these materials, it will be good. So I've had many people ask me to share with them books that are on sale. It's not because I don't like sharing, but because I'll be infringing someone else's copyright. I am myself writing a book on these concepts, and I wouldn't mind sharing them for free, or at least selling them for a token when I'm done writing them. But the point is, when it is a book written by someone else, I can't share it for free. I hope that answers it. Then someone here is asking, how do you get the instep? Oh, excellent question. So the instep, let me get back to the last. So I mentioned that this is a last, and you calculate your last length from the back here, running all the way down to the tip right here. So for me, the instep is somewhere here, right? So if you have a customer and you are measuring your customer, you can actually take that measurement and, you know, measure it around somewhere here. However, you remember that we got our ball, which runs from the outside here to the inside here, and that is our ball, right? So the point where the ball, this line that runs from the outside to the instep, the point where it crosses the center line, that wasn't visible. So the ball runs from here to there. So there is a line you draw all the way from there. The point where it intersects with this center line is called the vamp point. Those are the details that you will get if you watch some of my videos. So from that vamp point, what I typically do is I mark 1/4 of the last length on the center line, and that will give me an idea of the instep. Of course, if you had your customer and you measured him, you can also take it from the feet of your customer and then put it on the last, as the case may be. So that's it about the instep. So are there any other questions? Oh, someone said the audio is too low. Whoa. Oh, let me see. Yay, and I've been talking for almost 1 hour. Kai. I hope the audio is better now. Is the audio better now? I hope the audio is better now. Someone asks, how can he have access to the WhatsApp group? I guess that is for the admin of the WhatsApp group. Mr. Kushimo, please help this gentleman, Nathaniel Omuta. He's asking for how he can get access to the WhatsApp group. Then, I think there's also another question. Quite a number of people complaining about low volume. I hope it hasn't been that way all the way. Okay. Okay, I think this is a good place to call it quits for today. Kai. Okay, Mr. Shola Benson asked about the instep. I think I've answered that question. Okay, I don't see any more questions. I think this is a good place to call it a day. I'll take any other questions in the KLAN WhatsApp group. So I'll be on the, this is right on the top of the hour. So this is 9 o'clock. So I've been speaking for the last 1 hour or so. Any other questions,